So welcome to tonight's event here at the NYU Center for the Humanities. I'm Jane Tylas, co-director of the center with Uli Baer, who will soon be taking my role as moderator since I unfortunately have to run to another gig at the Casa Italiana. But it's great to be here to open tonight's panel. And it's always great to do events with Fordham Press. It's wonderful to see Tom Lai here. And I know a lot of you in the audience and a lot of people at these tables are Fordham authors. So it's a kind of nice Fordham reunion, as well as a Yale reunion, since everyone at these two tables at some point or another was at Yale studying directly with or indirectly with the protagonists of Mark Redfield's book. So let me introduce our author, Mark Redfield. I will then introduce our panelists, and then Uli will take over as our first speaker and our moderator. So the book under discussion tonight, as we all know, is called Theory at Yale, The Strange Case of Deconstruction in America. We're delighted that Mark Redfield, the author, could be joining us tonight. He is chair of the Department of Comparative Literature and professor of English and Comp Lit at Brown. His earlier books include Phantom Formations, Aesthetic Ideology and the Bildungsroman, The Politics of Aesthetics, Nationalism, Gender, Romanticism, and the Rhetoric of Terror, Reflections on 9/11 and the War on Terror. He's also co-edited High Anxieties. Come on in.
Sorry to be blocking the door.
He's also co-edited High Anxieties, Cultural Studies in Addiction, and edited, pertinently for his new book, Legacies of Paul DeMond. Uli Baer, who is in the middle of our table here, is professor of German and comparative literature and vice provost for Faculty Arts, Humanities, and Diversity. He has been the recipient of a Getty Fellowship, a Humboldt, and a Guggenheim, and his books include Remnants of Song, Trauma and the Experience of Modernity in Charles Baudelaire and Paul Celan, Spectral Evidence, The Photograph of Trauma, 110 Stories, New York Writers After September 11, and now in English as the Rilke Alphabet with Fordham Press, Das Rilke Alphabet. With Emily Sun and another of our panelists, Eyal Peretz, he co-edited The Claims of Reading, The Shoshana Feldman Reader. Uli is also a translator, as many of you know, Letters on Life, The Wisdom of Rainer Maria Rilke, and a writer of short stories collected in Beggar's Chicken Stories from Shanghai. So Uli will be speaking first. We'll then pass the torch to Mark. Our third speaker will be Eyal Peretz, who's joining us from Indiana University, where he is a professor of comparative literature. We're delighted you could weather the snowstorm in Indiana right now to come to New York. Eyal works at the intersection of literary theory, philosophy, psychoanalysis, and film studies, and he's especially interested in post-Enlightenment modernity. He's the author of Literature, Disaster, and the Enigma of Power, a reading of Moby Dick, Becoming Visionary, Brian De Palma's Cinematic Education of the Senses, and Dramatic Experiments, Life According to Diderot. And I've already mentioned his co-edited volume with Uli Baer. And again, we're delighted he could be with us tonight. You definitely win the prize for coming the furthest. And our last two speakers from NYU, I'm sure they need no introduction, but I'll briefly introduce them as well. Suzanne Wofford, who is the dean of the Gallatin School and professor of English, a distinguished scholar of epic poetry and of Renaissance and early modern literature. Suzanne has served as the president of the Shakespeare Association of America. Her publications include The Choice of Achilles, The Ideology of Figure in the Epic, Epic Traditions in the Contemporary World, The Politics of Community, which we co-edited together with another colleague, Shakespeare, The Late Tragedies, and Hamlet Case Studies in Contemporary Criticism. And Suzanne's current work includes a book project on Shakespeare and transnational Renaissance drama. Finally, to wrap things up, we have Jacques Lesra, professor of Spanish, English, and Comp Lit. His most recent book, also with Fordham, is Wild Materialism, The Ethic of Terror, translated recently into Spanish and Chinese. And a book on Cervantes, Contra los Fueros de la Muerte, is forthcoming, or is it out, Jacques? Sorry, forthcoming, okay, in Spanish, from Polifemo. While another book entitled On the Nature of Marx's Things is in preparation. And especially pertinent for tonight's discussion, Jacques is the co-translator into Spanish of Paul DeMond's Blindness and Insight. I'll also mention that with Emily Apter and Michael Wood, he's the co-editor of Barbara Casson's Marvelous Vocabulaire, the Dictionary of Untranslatables. And so really, with this, I leave things to Uli. I will just add that while you were all at Yale, I was down the street at Johns Hopkins were the three protagonists of Mark's book, Hartman, de Man, and Bloom were the Holy Trinity. So it will be really interesting to hear all of your comments tonight. Thanks, Uli, for taking over, and to all of you for being with us, again, despite the rain. Thanks again.
Thank you so much, Jane, and thank you, everybody, for coming, and thank you to my fellow panelists, and especially Mark Redfield for writing this book and getting us to think about the influence, lasting influence and impact of what's known as theory or the Yale School. First, I want to thank Tom Lee, and I want to note that this book is dedicated to the memory of Helen Tarter, who did so much for so many people who were shaped by this kind of formation, and I really want to take this moment to remember Helen, who was really critical for many of us in the room, who probably worked on the ideas and beginnings of this book. And she's a really much missed presence, I think, in all of these gatherings. And I think we can only hope that she can live on through books and events like this, where we actually try to get together and think seriously, which is something she was committed to, and to write serious, long studies of questions that concern everyone. So. To me, Helen was very, very dear and close, and she published my very first book, and we published other books with her, people on this panel did, so I think that's actually very important to note that. I will say very few things, then I will let Mark talk, and then the rest of the panel, and Mark situates the Yale School and theory in a particular place in American public discourse, as an intervention and a challenge to a kind of humanistic aesthetic education. And I would love to hear a little bit more about that, since this is a center for the humanities here at NYU, and Jane has been really kind of in the forefront of sort of making this the place where we can think about what is a humanistic education, what are the humanities. And as Marx says in the beginning of the book, he's very leery of the discourse of crisis, but it's what I want to say in 2 or 3 minutes is that deconstruction and theory for me was from the very beginning of my first exposure a kind of theory of affirmation. And I would like to say something about that. It always was an opening into something, into a future. And my first exposure to theory was really with my teacher, Avital Vonello, sitting here in the second row as a freshman at Berkeley when I was really impressionable and young. And I was assigned a reading list that essentially constitutes the entire canon of this, you know, Trinity, heavily centered in the French tradition, and I was just told to read these things, and it was pre-resistance. I didn't even know how to resist, so I sort of absorbed a lot of these things as a freshman. Then I learned as an undergraduate very quickly in a class with Sandro Natta at Harvard University, and I also studied with Barbara Johnson, that deconstruction is affirmative. And I remember so vividly in a sophomore seminar where I had to translate Schlegel that Sandra was telling us that deconstruction is an affirmation of things. And I want to sort of emphasize that, and I'll get to another example and then maybe illustrate that a little more clearly, and then I'll move on. So when I was at Yale with Eyal, with Emily Sun, who's sitting in the back, with Jared Stark and some other people, we were kind of in the PTSD program of after the Yale theory because everybody was sort of no longer quite in that formation, and it was after de Man had taught there and had passed away, and Geoffrey Hartman was my direct teacher, everybody else's teacher. But really, theory wasn't done in that way anymore, and there was a moment when it really wasn't done at all, and we kind of read all these things under the table in secret and silence, and we thought we had to assimilate everything. We read every single text by Paul de Man and discussed it, but outside of seminar. And I was just assigned exactly one text by Paul de Man while at Yale by Kathy Carruth, who was my other teacher. And I then wrote my dissertation under the direction of Geoffrey Hartman and Shoshana Fellman. And I'm noting these teachers, Avital Vonell, Kathy Carruth, Barbara Johnson, Shoshana Fellman, because those are kind of the women who, for me, were the people who took the Yale School. And as I think Suzanne will also say, from the beginning already, I think saw potential that this is an opening and not a foreclosed formation that actually shuts down yet again in a kind of boys club discourse, but actually here's an opening for people to do work that hadn't been done before. So my training was always done by people who felt this is an opportunity and an opening. Then, as Jane pointed out, Emily Sun and Eyal Peretz and I, we edited a book on Shoshana Fellman's work, and in the introduction to that book, Emily came up with a very important formulation for me for the last couple of years, and we try to understand what this kind of reading can do, and that it's not a kind of reading that finds errors and faults and slippages and mistakes, or the moment when language that's supposed to be stable and referential actually becomes accidentally or not or intentionally figurative. And this is kind of the misconceptions of the school that I think Mark will talk about and kind of takes apart why these misconceptions were more powerful almost in the public imagination than the real practice of reading. And in this introduction to this Shoshana Fellman reader, Emily said, these readings are not to show mistakes and errors, but to show where there's an opening in a discourse, where something can yet be said, when something can yet be understood in a different and new way, where if you want to use a different vocabulary, new frame of reference can be applied. And Emily said, it's not a matter of adding one more seat to Parliament and putting that person in and then we're all done, but to always keep one seat open, to always keep one spot open where something can yet be imagined. So that's my understanding of this affirmative dimension of theory or deconstructive readings, and I associate those two things. I think Mark makes a fine and important distinction. So how I came into this kind of practice of reading was through people who had used it as an affirmative practice, who were largely women, and who actually thought about what does it mean to open up discourse in a way that doesn't kind of explode it in ways that are meaningless, but actually in powerful ways to open up spaces for those people who haven't been heard, for those ideas that haven't been articulated, and to keep that open. And I have been discussing with my friends and colleagues for two decades now, really, this moment where something open can be maintained without being foreclosed and reinscribed and hypostasized again as the nothing, the absence, the lack, the error, the mistake, and all that, but actually where a kind of future is promised or opened up. And my own work, as Jane said, has really involved the idea of witnessing as a form of challenging existing frames of reference in contexts where experience is not reliable from the get-go, especially under situations of racist and other kinds of oppression. I've become, I guess, in a way, if you become these things, there probably was that, I was going to say I became a translator, but of course, English isn't my native language, so I've always been a translator to myself in a way in all the work I've done because I studied all this in English, which is not my native language. And so there was a possibility to open things up from within this kind of reading. And this affirmative potential is, I think, what I think is the most interesting legacy of the Yale School and of this kind of reading. And why we wanted to have this panel today is because my kind of self-involved understanding was always that no one in the academy does any work without having been touched by this kind of theoretical formation. I may be completely deluded, and there are many, many people doing great work who've never heard of this, but I just don't quite think that's true and can be imagined. There are many people in the room today who really have probably much more informed things to say. John Guillory is here, who's featured prominently in the book. So hopefully we'll have room for conversation and discussion. Avital, Emily, Richard. So people are here. So I'll stop right here. Then Mark will go, Eyal, then Suzanne and Jacques. And then hopefully we'll have some room for a conversation and debate. So Mark, it's all yours now. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Uli. Thank you, Jane. Uli, thank you for those really moving remarks. Thanks to everyone who's taken time out of your busy day to come here. Just as a brief sort of anecdote, the very first talk I ever gave in my life 31 years ago was at a graduate student conference at NYU, and Jacques and I were on the same panel, and it was a panel on deconstructive theory of some sort. I don't remember what the topic was. So anyway, that that memory is adding another tincture of pleasure to the gratitude I feel for this event. So I have about 6 minutes worth of remarks prepared. I wasn't sure what it would be best to do, but I decided that since I can't assume that everyone here has read my book, I should give you the best summary I could of the core argument, while trying not to repeat the descriptive paragraph that you can read on the Fordham website or Amazon, or for that matter on the webpage that describes this event, because if you're here, you've read that. And if you have read my book or part of it, and thank you if so, I'm hoping that these remarks will still prove useful as as a memory jog and as a spur to conversation. So the point that I most want to stress is that this study, is not an objective history of literary criticism and theory, but rather a reflection on an interpretation of the mediatization of theory as deconstruction in the United States in the 1970s and early 1980s. As I remarked near the beginning of my first chapter, the rather thin and vexed notion of the Yale critics will hold quite limited interest if you're plotting out a conventional survey or intellectual history of literary theory. My interest in the Yale critics as a as a group, or as a moniker, is a byproduct, as it were, of my interest in how and why theory became a minor media event at a particular time in a particular context. And though the phrase minor media event here primarily means references and articles in the mainstream middle to upper brow print media, I use the term mediatization to blur the differences between the delivery systems of the academy and the wider print media, so as to be able to ask the overarching question, why, both in the media and mutatis mutandis in the academy, did theory become mediatized as deconstruction and as quasi-allegorically embodied in the figures of Jacques Derrida and Paul de Man, especially de Man, as the scale and the intensity of the wartime journalism scandal underscored? And my answer to this question is that theory was an aesthetic scandal. Deconstruction emerged as the threat to aesthetic humanist rationales of education. And the reason for this was that deconstruction puts into question, which is not to say deny, but puts into question the human directedness and epistemological reliability of language, a putting into question that is conveyed, which is to say mediatically distorted, and as it were, both muffled and amplified in violent misreadings of deconstruction. And that, as a side note, is why theory and canon destruction kept getting put together in the journalistic imaginary during the so-called canon wars, even though empirically speaking, most people most invested, say, in expanding the canon weren't even usually interested in high theory, and often quite the inverse. Put succinctly, I am retracing and countersigning de Man's analysis of theory as the resistance to theory in his famous essay of that name. So I can be, and have been, for instance, in a recent review in the Chronicle, accused of writing a deconstructive account of deconstruction in America. This is a charge that I accept, though I'm trying at once to respect the conceptual power of de Man's and Derrida's work while also situating the impact of those texts within an institutional and cultural context. The most significant of these for my argument is the structure of the American university, with its middle-class pastoral ideal of residential college, the residential college experience, its market choice model of electives, with the concomitant running debate about the respective merits of core curricula and educational freedom, its early professionalization of its teaching and research cadres, and so on. Accompanying the evolution of the American university system has been a century's worth of anxious commentary about the role of and the teaching of the humanities at post-secondary institutions, especially at elite ones. And this is a uniquely American tradition. It's hard for me, at least, to imagine a bestseller like William Derezievitz, pronouncing his name right? Derezievitz's recent Excellent Sheep. To me, this kind of bestseller is inconceivable in Europe or Australia or Canada. It's very much an American discourse. Combine that overall context with Yale's important place in the American hierarchy of schools, plus this university's association in literary critical circles with a very socially respectable, Christianizing brand of new criticism in the 1950s, and you have the institutional conditions that allowed theory as deconstruction to become a public scandal in the 1970s and 80s. This scandal, as it formed itself in the 1975-1980 period, was focalized through the Yale critics. At the beginning of that period, Bloom and Hartman were drawing fire for being hyper-aestheticizing writers, for blurring the difference between criticism and literature. They brought that aesthetic jolt to the group as the Yale critics were gelling into a synecdoche for theory that is as Hyde theory, as deconstruction. Though very soon Bloom and Hartman were peeling off from this phantasmatic formation, which was forcefully narrowing down in the later 1970s to Derrida, de Man, and above all, de Man. And Bloom, of course, was to go on to become the personification of the Western canon in the 1990s, which is something I'm very interested in, and that's what my Bloom chapter is about. As I put it in my introduction, it's as though the fragile covalent bond of the Yale critics blew apart into its elements near the end of the 20th century, with Bloom and de Man quasi-allegorically figuring aesthetics and theory opposed. I believe, and I've tried to show, that this history calls out for a rhetorical analysis of the dynamics of personification and of our culture's anxiety about language, language in the most capacious sense as mediation, figuration, deracination, iterability. In other words, it is indeed necessary to pursue a deconstructive reading of the phenomenon of deconstruction in America. So that's the core argument of my book. This is my last paragraph. Only the long first chapter provides extensive historical narrative. The others are built around close readings. One of my ambitions is to try to access scatterings of textual density that drag Hartman and Bloom into the orbit of Demonian theory, so as to grant this assemblage of critics, that is, Yale critics, who were all really quite different from each other, a certain, if limited, and intermittent logic. Because I'm above all focusing on the reception of theory as deconstruction, my chapter on de Man takes the form of an extended critique of John Guillory's extraordinary reading of Demanian theory as a symptom of literature's loss of cultural capital in a techno-managerial era. And because I'm interested in shaking up the idea that strong perceptive readings of deconstruction are a purely intra-academic phenomenon, I close the book with a look at two paintings by Mark Tanzi from 1990. Derrida queries de Man, which is the painting on the flyer, and on my book cover, and Constructing the Grand Canyon, which is a painting in the American Sublime style that offers us the Yale critics at its perspectival center. I can project these images later if people would like to discuss them further. Uli actually suggested I do this while I talk, and I realized I'm just not coordinated enough.
Can you do it now?
I can do it now. At least if you know how to get me to the PowerPoint. So finally, I'm very much looking forward to this discussion. Thank you. But I'll run through these. So now we go to play slideshow, right? Hang on. Well, all right, I'll just do it this way. Yeah. So this is this is Derrida queries de Man. The title is itself inscribed in the painting. It's hard to see, maybe impossible to see in this reproduction, but it's in the lower right-hand corner. Whether to trust the title or not is, you know, certainly not a pre-given. And that painting is modeled on Sidney Paget's illustration for the Sherlock Holmes story, The Final Problem, from 1893. And you can see that Tanzi has changed the disposition of the bodies somewhat, turned a struggle into an ambiguous struggle dance. And of course, what he's done with these sequence that I call theory paintings is to silkscreen text in the background. This text comes from page 146, 147 of Blindness and Insight. There are also two paintings from this period that use page 112, 113 of Jacques Derrida's Of Grammatology in Gayatri Spivak's translation. You probably recognize this painting from the cover of the first edition of the Norton Anthology of Critical Theory. The second edition has an image of Cy Twombly's, I suspect, so as to repress the traumatic intersection between deconstruction and theory. But that's just me. So here I reproduced and here's a detail of what the silkscreen text looked like. And just, I'll stop with this. This is the painting Constructing the Grand Canyon. And actually, I'll show you one more slide just because it can blow it up. In the center, you see the Yale critics, de Man and Derrida, exactly at the perspectival center of the painting, with Bloom atypically dapper, pensive in the foreground, and Geoffrey Hartman sprawled in the middle. Here's a better close-up. Oh, sorry, did I do something? And this is quoting Raphael School of Athens.
In the introduction to the book, narrating an episode serving as a testimony to the persisting ability to disturb the demand and the question of theory hold, Mark Redfield gives us what we can perhaps understand as the psychic drama around which the book revolves. Describing an image printed in the Chronicle of Higher Education following the publication in 2013 of Evelyn Barish's biography of Paul de Man.
Yeah, be sure to speak into the microphone. Thank you.
Yeah, see, thanks. Redfield writes, "It is a disturbingly violent image. An archaic impulse to dehumanize through defacement has been triggered here, I think, by the backwash of de Man's allegorical role. Every square inch of this face, the face of theory, is being branded so as to efface its humanness. And the man is being effaced as a human being out of a desire to have him give a face to theory. For of course theory does not have a face and cannot have one, except by way of an act of figuration that, as here, can turn violently dehumanizing. What is it about theory and the man, Redfield continues to ask, that inspires such aggression? Psychoanalysis tells us the symptoms constitute efforts to bind anxiety. And if the man is right, the anxiety is about language. The allegorical labels inscribed on the image of the man's face relay hunger for fixed meanings, for signs as recognizable as faces, for faces as transparent as signs. But signs are not transparent, and faces only seem natural." End quote. A drama of giving a face and of defacement, then. Of giving a face, that is, of resolving a crisis to identity, making something recognizable through defacement, through a wounding aggression towards the human face, which tries to fix it, to stabilize it as an identity. As one fixes identity, one takes away the human face. The aim of such aggression, Redfield implies, is to defend against a prior defacement, a prior wound, something we can think of as an originary wound, perhaps, which Redfield, following de Man, associates with the exposure to the dimension of language as such, and which we can understand in this context as a non-natural, thus not reducible to the principles governing the phenomenal world, power of non-identity and non-recognizability, a power of estrangement. This originary defacement, to be distinguished from aggressive defacement, which actually tries to give a fixed face, is what occupies the heart of what Redfield calls humanness. Humanness, then, is the originary wounding which is the exposure to language and which aggressive defacement attacks. We might therefore draw the conclusion that it is the human face which is what most readily calls to be aggressively attacked through a wounding identification, the giving of a fixed face, precisely because it is itself, paradoxically, an originary site of defacement, an originary site in which what is expressed is our relation to language. If theory, as Redfield, following de Man, suggests, can be understood as the engagement with language, then the face as originary defacement becomes perhaps its privileged phenomenal focus, a phenomenal site whose very essence is the expression of the non-phenomenal, i.e. language. But the human face is of course not only a privileged site of originary defacement, but also a site holding a power to grant identity, in the sense of the power to allow one to have a place in the world. Only someone who can be exposed to the power of defacement and disidentification can be someone who receives identity, who is allowed a place in the world that is not given in advance. The human face is a privileged phenomenal site of the tension between defacement and the origination of identity. And when a face is aggressively attacked, it can also be in the manner of accusing it of having failed in a task that belongs to it, to grant identity. There is a traditional figure who was seen as standing for the power to assign identity, and this figure is the father. Yet the father, as he was traditionally conceived, functioned by manner of very specific interpretation of the possibility of giving identity. He was someone who assigned identity not by reference to a more originary, non-natural power of disidentification, out of which the possibility of identity emerges, but in reference to, or in the name of, a transcendent authority, call it the divine, that was itself conceived on the model of a predetermined identity. The face itself was brought under this paternal power and its transcendentalizing procedure to such an extent that we can speak of a paternal overtaking of the face. We can conceive of this overtaking as the attempt to detach the facial power to originate identity from its linguistic and abyssal background, and to ground this power to identify in a transcendent, predetermined identity. Such paternal overtaking of the face could thus be viewed as an original aggressive defacement. If paternity is a procedure attempting to eliminate the relation to the disidentifying power of language by grounding it in transcendence, then theory, as the bringing into view of language, can be understood as that which brings about an ungrounding, a falling of the father. But if the paternal mechanism, as I'm suggesting, is also inextricably involved with an overtaking of the face as the phenomenal center of defacement, then theory could also be understood as involved in an attempt to restore to the face something we might call its expressive powers, its humanness, and grounding it from paternal fixation. This is perhaps the implicit desire haunting Redfield's book, and which brings it, in a way that is perhaps surprising and possibly semi-unconsciously, to be bookended by images, an image of and as defacement at its opening, and an artistic image which seems to be a non-defacing image, and possibly, though Redfield does not exactly go there, an image managing to restore the human face at its very end. It is as if the artistic image, which we may define as a phenomenal appearance of strangeness, is that which fulfills an almost unarticulated desire occupying the heart of theory, to finally restore to the face its haunting expressivity. It is as if only in the image, an image that is thus the secret desire of theory, can the face return to itself. And if the face can return to itself only with the falling of the father, then the image is inevitably the showing of such a fall. This can be perhaps glimpsed in one of the paintings with which Redfield ends his book, Mark Tanzi's Derrida Queries the Man, which he describes as a theoretical painting, and which we can understand as the appearance of the image at the site of the falling of the father. Not unlike the first image, this image is composed as well of writerly and perceptible elements. But unlike the first image, where the written served as an instrument of defacement of humanness through fixing the face, here the written, most significantly perhaps the title Blindness and Insight inscribed on the verge of the abyss, becomes a manner of unfixing, of detaching our eyes from the identity of the perceptible and exposing them to an elsewhere that has no identity. An exposure that marks our encounter as an encounter with the event of falling of the fathers of deconstruction. For the fathers of deconstruction refused to be fathers, but rather attempted to be the site of a fall, and thus find themselves in an image. The image blinds us in the sense of interrupting our perception in order to give us insight to the fall. Writing on the surface thus becomes an attempt to turn the painting into the site of the expressivity of a face, in the sense of the phenomenal showing of an originary defacement that we can glimpse at the place of a paternal falling. I'm going through this very quickly, though, since it is to another theoretical image, an even more striking one, I think, showing the relations between the paternal face, defacement, the event of falling, and the achievement of a face as a new expressivity of strangeness that I would like to turn. I'm talking about the ending of a very strange, somewhat ludicrous and excessive film that is nevertheless, or perhaps due to this, a favorite of mine, Brian De Palma's The Fury, itself from 1978, the heyday of theory. The story of two psychically gifted adolescents with telekinetic powers, one of whom is a son who has been kidnapped, taken away from a father whom he believes dead, and thus by whom he feels abandoned, and the girl recruited by the father to help in his searches for the son. As the film reaches its end, the father and the girl arrive at the house where the son is being held by another paternal figure, an evil father, a paranoid construction, not unlike the paranoid construction of the man as an evil father, which Redfield briefly discusses, occupying the site of the failure of the good father. Finally finding the lost son, the good father hopes for a reunion, but the abandoned son is too filled with rage over his abandonment and refuses to accept the return of the father, a return in which the function of the face is emphasized. Instead, the son defaces the paternal face by wounding it, as if trying to disidentify it, as a revenge for his loss of identity, and perhaps also trying to fix it as face, to somehow prove its reality and restore it to its paternal function. But also, and perhaps most importantly, the son's defacement of the father is an unmasking, the uncovering of the face as originary wound underneath the recognizable paternal face. This unmasking becomes the site of the father's, and thus inevitably of the son's, fall.
Wow.
Yet if it is a fall that indeed occurs out of the wounding to the paternal face, out of his scarred face, a fall it is the task of the artistic image to show, we also witness here the birth of the face as the site for an immemorial expressivity, an expressivity of strangeness enabled by the release from paternal fixation, an expressivity which is the final aim of the artistic image. For as the son falls, and as if out of his own wounds, the marks of paternal abandonment, a new communication opens between the two youths through the cinematic facial close-up. We can see how the close-up here becomes a strange showing of a face that gains its expressivity precisely because it is a face that is as if defaced. The closer we get to the face, the more we lose it. Yet the more we lose it, the more it becomes expressive as face, as a human, which is by essence and paradoxically an inhuman, strange and unrecognizable face. The face becomes the expressivity of an originary defacement. It is the eyes, transformed from organs of perception into being communicators of blueness, blueness standing here for a sky emptied of transcendence, a sky with which the film opened, that become the markers of the achievement of this new expressivity of a face liberated from paternal fixation and emerging out of the sight of the wounded paternal face. The expressive face is a face of which effacement is an immanent dimension, the origin of its expressivity. Expressivity, we can therefore say, is the communication of originary defacement, of our exposure to abyssal language, which also becomes the source for new possibilities of meaning that are ungiven in advance. It is thus in the artistic theoretical image that the face achieves its expressivity as the showing of an effacement immanent to the face. And this expressivity is understood as a new kind of power or force. And force is here one of the main concepts haunting Redfield book, as they do demands and Derrida's ever. The expressive force of the face of the daughter in close-up. And it is crucial that it is the daughter rather than the son that has managed to fully open to the new expressivity of the face, which connects us, I think, to Uli's point about the relation between the women inheritors of the man and the new possibilities that they open. To transmit this blueness, the non-transcendentally occupied elsewhere, a force that finally manages to eliminate the paternal face and fulfill the desire of theory.
I think I'm here to represent the experiential aspect of things. And in some ways, much of what I wanted to say was already said by Uli, in fact. But I wanted to start by saying that when I started as a student at Yale, William Wimsatt was teaching literary theory, and the period of new criticism was still in strong element of the pedagogical structure of the university. I was an undergraduate. I came back a couple years later to do a PhD in comp lit. And I think it must have been around 1977, something like that. I went to this class by this guy named Paul DeMann that was on irony. Now, I didn't somehow imagine the idea that a course on irony might be taught by someone who is highly ironic. So I went to this class, and I have to say, among other things, that I still remember practically, I mean, close to verbatim, some parts of this extraordinary opening lecture, which attacked Wayne Booth for a long time, 3 hours or more. But at the end of the class, this teacher said, you know, of course, I'm not good at imitating his accent, but it was an important part of his charisma. No one should take, oh, I should say, there were 50, 60 people packed into this classroom. No one should take this class who is not fluent in German. All the texts are, so many of them are from German, you wouldn't really be able to understand. So I really encourage everybody who doesn't know German to go out and study German and come back later. So of course, being a naive graduate student, I walked out of the class and deregistered from it and started studying German. So that ends. That was the sad career of my relationship with what was, I think, one of the most important courses taught in those years, Paul de Mont's course on irony. Later I did a tutorial with him, but I have to say that that was clearly one of the great mistakes of my career. And that sense of irony, de Mont was a highly ironic thinker and person, and his way of putting ideas always involved a sort of ironic question rather than an assertion. And I think that there's something in the voice and the quality of those ironic questionings that for me is somewhere at the heart of deconstruction. I wanted to, so in a kind of ironic way, for me there's a very oral sense of what those years were like. And at that time, Allegories of Reading hadn't been published. There was a lot of de Mont's writing was not available. And people went to the seminars in part to be part of this sort of evolution of a theory that really was worked out in this, don't want to call it a discussion format, but in a very, very importantly connected to this set, a kind of ironic wit as its way of putting its ideas forward. And I wanted to say that there's something about the, well, maybe first I'll say another thing, which is that in one way, I kind of disagree with a small element of Marx's book in that, and maybe you are sort of implying this in a sense. First of all, I love the notion of the covalent bond between these allegorical figures of de Mont and Bloom, who become personifications. And I think the question of that way, how things evolve into that sense of allegory or personification of certain stances is really interesting. But I did want to say that for me, in my experience at Yale in those years, there was, I think, a much closer link between New Criticism and deconstruction than it's sometimes implied. And even your phrase, the Christianizing brand, which you also talk about in the introduction of the book of New Criticism, certainly there were people who were new critics who had a Christian point of view on the world and occasionally on text. It's not something that one encountered in my experience in classes at all or in readings of literature. It was not the case that new criticism was really a form of close attention to certain kinds of verbal details. So I see a real continuity from the early 50s and the pedagogical impulse of New Criticism into the close reading of deconstruction. At least that's how I experienced it. And in a way, I feel like one of the interesting things about this book is that I really do think there is an interesting question of what the metaphor of a school is. The Yale School, and it, you know, I've come in my course of my years as an academic to believe that there are these kinds of schools, and they have to do with the intersection of the publication, what you talk about it as the media attention to certain kinds of things, but also a particular kind of training that certain people coming out of these different theoretical intersections have. And so I guess that for me, one of the things I wanted to say, the Yale School, the experience of what that school was in a variety of ways for me somewhat wider than what the way that the book frames it. So I think that what you talk about as the way that different theorists and then de Mont essentially has success and becomes the figure that sort of personifies something that could be called high theory. The phrase high theory itself assumes that there are only certain kinds of, there's something high, that's sort of like the high Renaissance, right? We don't use that anymore, that phrase. So there were a lot of kinds of theory that were part of the Yale School. And I guess I do think that de Mont does develop this intensive sort of allegorical quality. But I also think it's important to look at some of the other aspects of it. And I wanted to say that one of the most amazing things about the period was the intense excitement, the intellectual excitement that you were speaking of when you were speaking of the openness and the sense of new ideas all the time, being the sense of discovery and surprise. And I thought I would just read a couple of words. This is Barbara Johnson from 1980. She says, as soon as any radically innovative thought becomes an ism, its specific groundbreaking force diminishes, its historical notoriety increases, and its disciples tend to become more simplistic, more dogmatic, and ultimately more conservative, at which time its power becomes institutional rather than analytical. This is in an essay called Nothing Fails Like Success, which you can also find in the Barbara Johnson Reader. And she goes on to say, what can a reader who has felt the surprise of intellectual discovery in a work by Jacques Derrida or Paul de Man do to remain in touch, not so much with the content of the discovery, but with the intellectual upheaval of the surprise? And that quality seems to me something that was so central, both to those years and to the reason that this kind of theory became so central, as you said, to so many different kinds of widespread literary endeavors that take very different theoretical frameworks. She writes, how then can one set oneself up to be surprised by otherness? And this was something that was, I think, a key question. What does the surprise encounter with otherness, what the surprise encounter with otherness should do is lay bare some hint of an ignorance one never knew one had. The surprise of otherness is that moment when a new form of ignorance is suddenly activated as an imperative. And I guess that to me, one of the questions that I sort of wanted to think about a little bit, it was often talked about in even now one hears sometimes this sense that theory was very male. And in some ways I feel like allowing the allegoresis of the Bloom de Man, it leaves out some things that were so central. And the two names obviously for me that were the most important were Shoshana Fellman and Barbara Johnson. And Barbara is second generation in a sense, but I'm not sure I think Shoshana is. And the centrality of psychoanalysis and the way that she provided a way into feminism and the linkage between deconstruction and feminism as methods, I feel like that's also part of the Yale School in a really important way. So in a sense, the sense of there being a kind of intensification of de Man as sort of the victor in a struggle, to me leaves out something that I think is really the fertility of what happened with deconstruction in terms of its power in the academy. And one thing I would say is that if you look at the great students of these figures across the American Academy and I think abroad, you see people doing extremely diverse, very powerful cultural, social criticism, a great variety of types of work, feminist work, that are being drawn, that are using the qualities of deconstruction that are so important. And so I guess I feel as though, is it really true? De Man was an enormously inspiring and brilliant critic, but is it really true that he won, as it were, in a sort of story of success? I mean, I do think you're right that he is taken up by the media in a particular way, but that in itself is an interesting question. I thought I would just take a minute to read a tiny bit more because I thought it captured what for me was so much a central experience of deconstruction. And this is, again, this is from Barbara Johnson talking about what it means to teach deconstructively. And I guess for me also, and this is something that has to do with that notion of the Yale School, but the pedagogy, the sense of teaching, the centrality of a teaching method is somehow very much a part of what this is about. So part of the problem of the media is that it relied on what was published and written, and I don't know that it was as interested in the pedagogy. And so for me, that was, anyway, I'll just read a tiny bit. Barbara writes about the various things that are said about what deconstruction could be negatively. Deconstruction has sometimes been seen as a terroristic belief in meaninglessness. It is commonly opposed to humanism, which is then seen as an imperialistic belief in meaningfulness. Another way to distinguish between the two is to say that deconstruction is a reading strategy that carefully follows both the meanings and the suspensions and displacements of meaning in a text, while humanism is a strategy to stop reading when the text stops saying what it ought to have said. Deconstruction, then, has a lot to teach teachers of literature to the extent that they see themselves as teachers of reading. What, then, is a deconstructive reading, and how can its strategies be translated into classroom procedures? Deconstruction is not a form of textual vandalism or generalized skepticism designed to prove that meaning is impossible, nor is it a prior assumption that every text is self-reflexive, that every text consists only in a play of signifiers, or that every text is about the relation between speech and writing. Rather, it is a careful teasing out of the conflicting forces of signification that are at work within the text itself. If anything is destroyed in a deconstructive reading, it is not meaning per se, but the claim to unequivocal domination of one mode of signifying over another. This implies that a text signifies in more ways than one, that it can signify something more, something less, or something other than it claims to, or that it signifies to different degrees of explicitness, effectiveness, or coherence. A deconstructive reading makes evident the ways in which a text works out its complex disagreements with itself. And I just wanted to say that that, which I think is a wonderful summary of a deconstructive pedagogy, is extremely close to what I would say my new critical teachers were teaching me in the sort of later days of new criticism. So one question I have is what really is the genealogy? Of course, the importance of a European philosophical canon might be the descriptive definer of high theory. If you're not doing philosophy and literature, you're not doing high theory. But I do think there's a rootedness in that new critical close reading, which is describable very close to what Barbara writes here. So those are some thoughts about, again, as you put it, the women who were very important to my experience of theory at Yale.
Thank you. Just one or two brief comments before we begin our conversation. This has been a difficult book for me to read because it's a little bit like reading about myself. Every one of the kind of benchmarks is I see my little face there at age, I don't know, 19, 20, 21, and it's really quite disturbing, Mark. I don't know how the hell you managed it, but it's problematical. When I was teaching Lit Z, it was called Lit 130, Reading and Rhetorical Structures. And bizarrely and rather interestingly, its competitor, Lit 120, which was the narrative course, was where the Sherlock Holmes stories were taught. interestingly, because Peter Brooks had absorbed those as the examples of a kind of meta-theoretical narrative or narratological approach to text, and Daman was reading Blanchot and Henry James and things like this on his side. And Brooks was reading Conan Doyle on his side. As Jane mentioned, and I'd like to just underscore one aspect of this. As Jane mentioned, my closest, most intimate encounter, I suppose, with Daman came in the translation of Blindness and Insight into Spanish. And I want to emphasize perhaps three things about that, which is conjunctural. First of all, that it's into Spanish, that the text was published at the University of Puerto Rico Press, that it was the first translation into Spanish of Daman's work. One of the things that was very clear in the Yale Comp Lit department that I entered in 1984, I think it was that the axis of comparativism was French and German. Spanish was always not just secondary, it was barely tertiary or quaternary. And Italian was there mostly because Frachera was there, because Mazzotta was around and things like this. But Spanish was really low on the I'm not going to call it a totem pole, but it was, if you wanted to think of it as a ladder, it hadn't even made it to the first rung of the ladder. So it was a bit haphazard and hazardous to begin translating Daman into Spanish. It wasn't clear that there was going to be much of a market for it, and indeed for that first book, which was published in a horrendous series in an awful, unfindable, and destroyable, horrible edition, it barely made any impact at all. But it was crucial, at least to my development, to think that Dominionism and Dominion deconstruction was not simply limited to that specific couplet of traditions of the French and the German, and that comparativism more broadly was not the purview of French and German intellectuals who had emigrated to the United States seeking a more utopian or better better dimension, but rather that Spain, Spanish, Latin America could be in dialogue with, benefit from, and bring something themselves to bear to Dominion deconstruction. So that was one thing that has remained with me intensively, and I think very importantly for my career, my life since then. The other thing was that that was a collaborative project. It was a project of translation as collaboration. That has become central to my life at the moment. Most of my translating projects are collaborative, but it, I think, speaks also to something that has to do with what Suzanne was referring to as the notion of the school. It seems to me that one of the things that is critical about thinking about deconstruction in this moment and theory in this moment is of it as a collaborative effort. And I don't mean collaboration in any sort of facile and wonderfully huggy-huggy sort of way, but rather collaboration in the way that Holmes and Moriarty can be said to be collaborating at the brink of the Reichenbach Falls. Right? This is, they're doing some kind of very terrible dance on the edge, but they're doing it together. And at least in that story, they both go down. Of course, we later find out that Holmes climbs out because, you know, that's what people tend to do in further stories. But the nature of collaboration is that it's indistinguishable, and perhaps undecidably so, from fratricidal combat, right? And that's also true of the nature of collaboration in translation. Translations, when you're collaborating with another translator, you are in some kind of strangely erotico-fratricidal battle, and you're in that same kind of erotico-fratricidal battle with the author whose work you're translating. That seems to me to be indissociable from deconstruction. But that, I think, was not clear to us in the 80s and in the 90s, until rather recently, the articulation of deconstruction with the figure of translation has become much clearer. And finally, the person with whom I was translating that book, my dear friend Ugo Rodriguez Becchini, now dead, was one of the first gay people that I worked with very, very closely. For me, it was an extraordinary opportunity to enter into a world, a conversation, a set of possibilities that was allowed to me, for me, by the work of collaborative translation in that specific way. That is, fratricidal, erotic, collaboration where you're working really, really hard late into the night over tremendously strong Puerto Rican coffee to get something right about a text. And I can't think of a better way of thinking about deconstruction or about the Yale School than that. Really, really late night, coffee-laden, fratricidal, but also kind of eroticized translating sessions. And with that, I'll leave you.
Thank you. I don't know, maybe Mark, you want to say something at all? you know,
I'd really rather hear what other people have to say.
And I think we should, if you're okay with that, we could immediately open it up. People want to comment, or are you giving us a lot of images, Jacques, of this title now to see Jacques and Paul and this kind of dance?
Well, I wonder if I could just add one more thing, which is that I thought it was, I loved your reading of the book being framed by images, and I loved the chapter on the images, and I thought they were very powerful and really fascinating. And I guess I wasn't really disagreeing with the case that you were making, as well as just saying that another book on theory at Yale could include Jameson, who was a very important figure during those years, could include, you know, not necessarily moving to fratricidal collaboration, which I think is, since we've had images of family destruction and falls, et cetera, but I wanted to say how much I enjoyed it.
Well, maybe I could just say one thing really quickly, which is thank you, Suzanne, for that. I did try occasionally to render the sense that people were feeling that an event was occurring, and that sense of openness and surprise. But I wasn't providing the kind of thick description that you guys are testifying to, which is tremendously important. And I also realized from page one that I was repeating and taking the risk of repeating the awkwardness with which Vlad Gozic, Jonathan Eric, and Wallace Martin exclude Shoshana Feldman and Barbara Johnson, most obviously, but a whole question of, you know, what is a Yale critic? And precisely because I took that risk, because I wanted to try to follow out the way in which they were constructed that way.
Sure.
Maybe if I can sharpen this point a bit. So in some ways, I think what we all try to do is, the way I was reading Suzanne's and Jacques' comments, that deconstruction in some ways it's an opening up, and it's a way of showing how something, as Barbara Johnson said, something in a formation of discourse, in a mode of signification, one mode of signification never dominates entirely, but something else can surface and rise. But at the same time, it was a very powerful formation and did exclude, in very powerful and complicated institutional ways. The women we've all mentioned are not just markers of something, but there were lots of other people who were displaced. There's a kind of effacement of, there must have been, I know there were, other people teaching literature at Yale who I don't think felt really good that suddenly three people ruled the universe in the media and in the, you know, some kind of imaginary space for students and other people. So I think, how come this theory, which is supposed to open up these kind of open spaces, actually also has this impact or excluded so much? And that contradiction, I think, is fundamental. What you're trying to show is, why did the media pick this up? Why did the media give the face of theory to Paul DeMond? And then Eyal's work is, DeMond talked about the face as this a terrifyingly stabilizing need that we give a face to something, and then when the Chronicle then defaces DeMond's face, it's a very violent act, but they feel they're doing it completely on the right side of everything because DeMond turned out to be a terrible person. But so this contradiction, or if it's a contradiction, tension or something of this opening, and yet it's also a very, let's say, forceful formation. And I do invite people to jump in. So Richard and Emily, can we go for the two of you in a row? Yeah. Sorry, can you hand this mic back right there? There's a mic in front of you. Thank you.
Just a kind of literary historical perspective.
I think it's on.
It's on.
I think it's on.
Just a literary is it on now?
I think so.
Yeah, just a kind of literary historical perspective, and also responding to the imagery. To what extent this, quote, school or this nebula at Yale actually emerges very much about a discussion and a conflict about romanticism. So your image, the images that you've chosen and that you've shown are actually saturated with the imagery of the sublime. And the way from, this actually connects Yale to Cornell and the work on romanticism, Abrams, Hertz, the end of the line, the whole discussions about the sublime, whether it be a Burkean sublime or a Kantian sublime, and this attempt to this need to kind of recover a different kind of romanticism from that which was rejected by Eliot, rejected by Pound, rejected by the New Critics. De Man's early work is on Herderlin and Rousseau. Hartman starts out remarkably as a Wordsworth scholar. The key piece in Deconstruction and Criticism is actually probably Derrida's Borderlines, which is an attempt to conjoin a reading of Shelley with Blanchot, etc. Even the figure of irony that you were talking about, Suzanne, which I would disagree. I mean, for Empson, there are seven kinds of ambiguity, and the attack on Booth is in fact the ultimate controllability of irony. But De Man goes back to Schlegel, and to precisely a rereading of the German Romantic tradition, perhaps via Benjamin. But it seems to me that the big literary historical kind of turf war, I think, really has to do with romanticism and a way of thereby redefining modernism, and hence perhaps a kind of postmodernism. But this is only a kind of a literary historical take on this.
Is it okay if Emily goes? Can you?
Thank you. I was very moved by these comments, all of you, so thank you. I was wondering also about, to add to romanticism, there's also, of course, via Shoshana Feldman, particularly the way in which French theory comes together with romanticism. They weren't obviously converging, but it happened, and it happens. You begin to see this in some of the topics for seminars that get worked out between De Man and Derrida when they're writing back and forth to each other. I'm sure Avital can add to this too in terms of what Derrida was thinking about. So I think the other conduit that came through not just De Man, but De Man-Fellman was psychoanalysis, was a whole current of French theory. And they had at Yale, I think, the kind of morphological structuralist tradition already going with Jacques Herman.
Yeah.
You mentioned the New Critics, but he was very important.
Yes, right, it's true.
And I think that gets forgotten from this history. And the other text where there are these convergences that are so, I think, important is about the pedagogical experience of time. Mm-hmm. I sat in on some of De Man's classes and Derrida's as well, and there was always a sense of the now time, of the moment, the place I'm speaking from. And when you did a critique of the rhetoric of temporality, what pushed back against it was the performative moment of the seminar, the pedagogy, as something unexpected.
Yeah.
And this, as I completely agree with what you're all saying, that this got absolutely effaced by the media.
Yeah.
It wouldn't make sense. It wouldn't translate out. It was something that actually happened as a performative experience. And it was also linked to pedagogies that were translative in the sense that Europe was, there was a lot of back and forth. Yeah. It wasn't just Europe.
Yeah.
There were people converging from many different places. So. And there wasn't just a Parisian classroom that was all white and all French.
Right.
People were coming from Latin America. They were coming from Africa. I mean, I think all of that history has been completely forgotten.
Yeah, that's completely right, I think. You put it so well. Sorry. I think you put that really well, Emily.
But I think the classroom, a pedagogy experience, was translated by the media into the cult of people who were followers. So it became these people who are Damanians, who are Derridians, or deconstructors. And I think there's a sense that gets translated into you are followers and initiates into a kind of the question of a school. And that's why I think gender is really important, because it became these, what you said, fratricidal. I can't really get this image out of my head now. And I am not even thinking about Eyal's images here. What is at stake at instituting a school that then is supposed to be disseminated all over the world, as you're pointing out? And it was, I think Jacques' example, the first translation into Spanish published in Puerto Rico, but Derrida reached a lot of people who came to actually understand what is subjectivity, how is it constructed. I think your question about romanticism, because it goes to the heart of the academy. You read poems to find yourself, presumably. They didn't make that so easy anymore. But people came to see these seminars and say, how do we construct ourselves in this new era? And are these tools to do that or not? So I think all these things are sort of political, ideological, aesthetic questions that can come together there.
I just want to make a suggestion that's a little off topic, but I think what Emily just described is arguably true about instruction in the humanities now and in relation to the media. In other words, that the sense of the performative moment of the classroom is untranslatable into what is a mediatizable representation, and that some of the issues we have with this hugely problematic attack on the humanities in the broader political arena is related to the phenomenon you just described. It's much more intense in the version we're looking at, but I think it's arguably true in all sorts of ways that we should be able to confront today and think about. I don't know what to do about it, but I think it's helpful to see that broader picture.
I would ask Mark, in today's debate, nobody's attacking the humanities in the name of protecting literature or literary studies. Back then, they were attacking deconstruction as undoing literary studies in a traditional sense. That's gone in a way. So you don't hear people saying the humanities have become so over-theoretical. It's more sort of the attack is there, but there's no more prior literary studies to go to as an aesthetic education that makes people into good moral citizens or whatever they were supposed to become, which is what they were supposed to become. But maybe, Mark, you can say something about that, because that's part
sure.
of the argument of the book.
I would certainly agree that we live in a different moment than in the 1970s. There's no question about that. I think the attacks on the humanities are so various, you know, ranging from, was it just most recently the governor of Kentucky suggesting that French majors shouldn't be supported by state funding, you know, so it can run from that level to, you know, to many others. But I would certainly agree that we live clearly in a world that is differently mediatized, for one thing, with the explosion of the internet in the mid-1990s. If I could just say one thing really quickly. I am tremendously interested in Romanticism. I've written about it a lot, and that's one of the major themes of the book, as well as other books I've written. This book doesn't deal, I wish I had written more about psychoanalysis and the importance of psychoanalysis in, as it were, the Yale scene. I wanted to say something about Jacques Lacan's famous visit in 1975 to Yale, out of which came many anecdotes, but in the end, this wasn't a book that was going to tell anecdotes.
Right.
I collected a lot of them, and it just didn't work for me. For one thing, I wasn't a graduate student there. I was an undergraduate. I was marked by it, but then I went off to Cornell, Yale North, as Marilyn Butler put it, and she talked about the Yale-Cornell School of Romanticism. So, and Neil Hertz was actually the teacher where I had my aha Erlebnis. That was my de Man moment, was studying with Neil. So, you know, I think this, if we're talking about a thick description of how we actually were educated, there's no such singular place as Yale with these monumentalized figures. That's rather a product of a certain kind of reception process, and I really do want to underscore that, and I'm mm-hmm. tremendously interested by, you know, what people are saying. Thank you.
Oops. Can you pass the yeah. mic back?
Jacques mentioned this somewhat, but I wanted to mention a few more names in terms of performativity, because in 1977, I actually did attend the Lacan thing in 75. I was a student there. But in 77, you also had Umberto Eco, who I feel obligated
right.
to mention, and Paolo Felizio, and I feel obligated also to mention, because they produced some incredible women students, such as Barbara Spackman. So you do have this sense of, and in terms of, I was Umberto Eco's teaching assistant, the performativity in Eco's classes were, you know, the rival of the performativity of being in de Man's class as well. But so there really was that, and with Felizio as well. So, but these things also open up through semiotics, and with, I think, echo, you could trace out how important it was for the role of the reader, moving from a theory of semiotics to the role of the reader and more of reading, because of course all of this was before the mediatization of echo through the name of the rose and some of the things. Just as a side question, I reading the obituaries of echo this weekend, wondering why the word abstruse it's always used. I thought we were done with it, like with Jacques, but abstruse every time his semiotic work was mentioned. And I've never really thought semiotics was particularly abstruse as related to other forms of theory. It seemed to always have some pragmatic core. But there were all over the place during the time. And students who visited and were in conversation with people in the late 70s, such as Miriam Hansen, who was in a collective faculty seminar that had both people who were doing deconstruction, but also Umberto Eco and Geoffrey Hartman as well. So it did seem to be fluid, but still it was also, as you said, all about demand somehow.
Can you hand the mic to over there to Vital? Thank you.
Thank you for this very, very stirring series of remarks and for your book. And I think there's one place where perhaps you didn't want to take the off ramp, and I can do it and see what you think. and it's launched by what Suzanne quoted for us, and thank you also for reading everyone in this way again. Remember when Barbara Johnson designates the surprise of otherness, she says that it activates ignorance. And I think, and of course I've tried to throw myself into Demand, especially Demand's engagement with ignorance, of course with Schlegelian Unverständlichkeit, or to translate for Suzanne, unintelligibility.
I learned the German. It was just the irony I missed.
You caught it this time.
I'm just sequencing it disjunctively, which I know you can all handle. We've been trained in this. So media and dumbing down and an imperative to somehow, I'm just skipping around now, Demand really terrorized us with his absolutely unrelenting intelligence and demand that one step up and that one be able to join the vertiginous spirals of the ironic abyssal movement of his thought. As Richard rightly said, he's also, I didn't mean to be rude by saying rightly, of course you're right, you're always right, but of the containability of irony, according to Wayne Booth and others, whereas for Demand and Zundi, Peter Zundi on irony as well, that's a German critic. Demand just says there are no emergency brakes or containments or safety regs and rules for irony, but it can crash you and destroy you and so on and so forth. And nor did he contain his irony or destructive velocities, it seems to me, so that some of his students were notoriously crushed and silenced, not because, there are such teachers that psychoticize students. Kittler is one, Friedrich Kittler, and others are celebrity psychoticizers. I don't think he was necessarily to be named that way, but he did exert such a power of judgment and shutdown in case, God forbid, he found you to be stupid. And he's very, his work is does take recourse to stupidity. This is stupid, this is unacceptable, and so on and so forth. So I'm thinking, trying to think bifocally and too quickly, that the media also, this continues to be vertiginous, because inside, to say it undeconstructively, the university, there was also a resentment that these guys thought they knew it all, they were too smart, they made everyone else look stupid. So there was a lot of pressure. So that when Barbara Johnson affirms, as Uli, she's also his teacher, reminds us, the ignorance, the ecstatic openness to ignorance, that's almost also a slam. You know, really? You're now going to love ignorance, you're going to affirm it, you're going to... So there was something about, I don't think, I mean, to make it too quickly in that embrace and fratricidal kind of ambiguity, I don't know where I was going with that, but do you? I think there was something about the dumbing down that the media also implies, that also was an ironic countercurrent maybe to the overly smart profiling of the, I'll say it quickly, the deconstructionist, so that for the humanities, to get back to your urgent pleas and questions, there's so much overinvestment in what looks like secured cognition, scientific, epistemological ground, and so on and so forth. So that would be just a series of bullet points.
I wonder if I could just read two or three sentences from Mark's book to maybe go to some of these last questions via a remark that de Man makes at one point about Booth, precisely, in which he's talking about how Booth constructs the relation between the Aaron and the Alazon. Alazon, if you recall, is the idiot who gets tricked by the smart Aaron. And he rather ironically says, well, you never know, maybe Booth will turn out to have been the Aaron to my Alazon, but right now he looks like the stupid person to me, but who knows? Perhaps it will be otherwise. The sentences that I wanted to read have to do with this phenomenon of dumbing down that Avital was just mentioning. The word that Mark uses in his book is reduction. And if you go through the book and look for reduction, it has a couple of different senses, one of them at least a fairly technical sense coming out of phenomenology, but most often it's used as in this couple of sentences. This is for you, those of you who will go out and purchase 20 or 30 of these books, which I encourage you to do. Page 53, he's talking about the ad hominem argument that literalizes personification, effacing the difference between theorist and theory, and at the same time reducing the theorist to a minimal psychic point, a cold center of authority, ambition, ruthlessness. The turn of the screw effected by the wartime journalism scandal adds another layer of petrification. The theorist becomes a quasi-embodiment of guilt, a character so fixated on his wartime journalism that everything he writes decades later will constitute an excuse for it or a covert continuation of it. Reduced to the willfulness of a person, theory turns out to involve the reduction of a person to a personification, underscore personification there. And this seems to me one of the crucial methodological drives of this book, which is a critique of dumbing down as reduction of the person to a personification. What I would want to ask Mark is that lines up, I think, a little too comfortably with the hieratic position of the Iron, who is unhappy with the stupidity of the Alazan journalist. And I think that if I'm going to do my Demand sock puppet, if Paul were here, one of the things that he might be saying is, how do you know which comes first, the person or the personification? Isn't the potentiality of the reduction to the personification dependent upon the humanist notion that the person precedes the personification? And shouldn't we be prepared to flip it? This was, in my own pedagogy, the only thing that remains absolutely from de Man's classes is the bloody hand gestures, which I'm sure that my graduate students have also inherited now, and they don't know where they come from, but at least I think they come from de Man. Who knows? It may come. In any event, so shouldn't we be prepared somehow for the surprise of the inversion of the person and the personification as well? And surely that's where you're going in this book. If you could have, as it were, a deconstructive historiography of deconstruction, it has to do with the openness to the reversal of person and personification in a way that is vertiginous, like that.
Yes. the sentences you just read are kind of are in indirect discourse, right? They're miming. Eyal put this so beautifully. I can't remember the way you set it all up, but right, it's in the name of recuperating a person that a personification is generated.
Right.
Such that de Man comes to personify theory precisely so as to reduce theory to the machinations of an empirical human being. So that's a defense against precisely the undecidability of person personification that I think that you point to. And if I could also just say, I want to express my gratitude, Avital, to your remarks as always. I think what they do is they make us attend to the richness of the notion of openness that we've evoked at the beginning. If you're not careful, openness sounds just nice and positive, right? Like new ideas and growth through learning. And that's true. But openness is also an exposure to damage, to the risk of damage, the way you put that together with irony, I thought was very thought-provoking.
John, I don't want to put you on the spot, but if you do want to say something, I would love it. I'm having a bit of a moment because Jacques practically just channeled Paul de Man, who I never met, and I feel like I think you would have gone on for about 4 hours, I think, with that kind of, and then preceding that, which we don't know. But John, are you okay? Thank you.
It was a very convincing channeling, Jacques. a little scary, maybe.
Let's speak into the microphone thing. Yes, I think it's good. It's good.
Am I? Yeah. Okay. I'm at a disadvantage, Mark, because I haven't read your book yet. Okay. All right. But I'm very interested in the way in which the conversation developed around the issue of inclusion and exclusion. Mm-hmm. What is excluded from the domain of theory by the radical contraction of theory to the Yale School, and then to the figure of de Man himself. And you know, and I don't want to rehash any of our disagreements about de Man, but I certainly, in arguing for this mediatized image of de Man as something that actually happened, I certainly wasn't endorsing it. I think it was a terrible thing. Terrible for de Man, terrible for his students, and terrible for literary study. And one of the things that I think was really bad for literary study, for the future of literary study, was what went down with the Yale School, with the ship, as it were, of the Yale School. And one of those things was large domains of theory, including, of course, all of the names that have been mentioned. who were members of Yale literature departments and other departments elsewhere, but also historical periods of theory, including Anglo-American theory and New Criticism, for which de Man had tremendous admiration, and which he absorbed through Reuben Brower.
Yes.
So one of the things that it's always mystified me, and I wonder if you have any thoughts about this, is the peculiar irony, and I don't know whether de Man would have appreciated this irony or deplored it, celebrated or deplored it. I think probably deplored it. Was the way in which Anglo-American criticism was suppressed after the emergence of theory and the decline of the Yale School. That is to say, it went down with the Yale School. And we began to think about theory as, you know, whatever names got attached to that notion of theory with a capital T. We began to think about it in such a way that we could distinguish between what was theory and what was not theory, or what was theoretical and what was pre-theoretical. So names like Wimsatt, mm-hmm. And Wayne Booth ceased to belong to the domain of theory, mm-hmm. And even more unfortunately, Richards, Empson, yeah. All of those figures who themselves use that word theory. I know this because I'm been deeply immersed in reading them in recent years. They use the word theory all the time to describe what they were doing, and there was no reason not to accept that self-characterization. So you know, in the spirit of de Man's own openness, as it were, to those domains of theory that for some reason were excluded from the name of theory. After the decline of the Yale School, what do you want to say about that? What can we do to bring back those figures into the domain of theory? Even I should say, someone like Wayne Booth, and you know, I would say I'm on de Man's side about the issue of irony in his dispute with Wayne Booth. But so what? Wayne Booth is still a theorist, and why can't we have no theory that is diverse enough to sustain a much, much broader discourse without having to have theorists labeled Iron or Elazon and kicked out if they prove to be the Elazon figure?
Mm-hmm. I first want to thank you, John, for coming to this. I want to say this is a precious and weird moment for me because John Giller and I have actually never met, although we've corresponded once, and you know, of course, we have a lot of friends in common and so on. But I don't have an answer to the precise question you ask, which is, or two of the questions, how to bring it Anglo-American tradition back. But let me maybe repeat with a difference what I said at the very beginning of my remarks. What my project has been is to try to track a very specific thing, the mediatization of theory as deconstruction, how that happened, you know, what the context was, and then I do my close readings and so on and so on. And obviously I do it from a point of view that takes, you know, infinitely seriously the work of de Man and Derrida. But that's. But at the beginning of the book, I also work through the many different meanings of theory, which is a very charged and complicated word, which begins to have negative valence at the end of the 18th century as a Burkean slur in counter-revolutionary rhetoric, and that's partly where the personification of the theorist comes from a Robespierrean figure. David Simpson has written nicely about this, and I take up some of his analysis there. But these are symptomatic formations. What is theory in the more normative sense in which we use the term? It might signify deconstruction, but it might just as well refer to the work of Michel Foucault and a vast range of figures who populate syllabi that are called introduction to theory. And if de Man is lucky, one essay of his might be on that syllabus, but it's not that prominent. Nor is, and if you look at the Norton anthology, that canonizing apparatus, you know, Derrida in the first edition got about 70 pages, de Man about 20 out of an enormous collection. So what I'm doing is not the same as a, as it were, objective historical account of theory, of practice, theoretical practice in the humanities. It's rather trying to look at a symptom and analyze it. Does that remotely edge toward what you were saying?
I understand it, but I'm just hoping that you have some thoughts, having done this project, on how to undo what was so tragically done with the decline of the Yale School, because so many people went down with that ship. And shouldn't have gone down with it at all.
But the Yale School also went down with that ship. I'm not sure that, I mean, the ship is...
I don't think the Yale School should have gone down either, and I don't think de Man should have gone down.
Yeah.
Not at all.
I'll say one other thing really quickly. I have asked myself, and I should have put a page or two of reflection into this book, how do you account for a figure like Zizek under the terms that this book works out, the... figure of the theorist. Zizek is clearly a completely different personification or performance of a human being than the way de Man Derrida complex as allegorical of high theory happened in the late 20th century. So we're living in a different moment in that sense. And if anything, it seems to me that the a figure like Zizek needs to be understood in relation to the enormously complex cultural and technical mediatic changes over the last few decades. I'm thinking, of course, of the internet, the electronic electronicization of our profession. So I'm not sure that anything can be brought back or undone, although there could be forms of doing, perhaps, that recover and resituate. And you're doing it, probably.
The metaphor of the ship going down...
Before the ship goes down.
Let me just start flipping my fingers again. The metaphor of the ship goes suggests a kind of lack of agency just the disaster of the shipwreck or the tempest. I wanted to stress that there are names that could be named of academics who, acting in collaboration with the mediatized representation of deconstruction and theory, collaborated to purge Yale and Yale North of people who were in the Dominion camp by not granting tenure, by making life impossible. And those people are still with us. Some of them are retiring soon, we hope, but there was an active de-demonization of the profession that was the acting out of this personification in the most vicious and reprehensible way. And I don't think that we should tell the story without remembering the people who were the victims of it and the damn perpetrators as well.
The institutional politics, though. But what you just said, Mark, in a way that maybe by doing the things we're doing, I think, John, it's your question, how do you bring these names back? How do you bring anybody back? We can only bring them back by, I think, doing this. So I think I'll close. I want to thank the panelists. I want to thank people who contributed and who actually spoke very movingly, I think, about something that's mattered greatly. And I do think the only way to bring any name back of anybody is this kind of work. So that's how I, and aside from Jacques channeling directly, So, but thank you, Mark, for triggering this conversation. There's a reception outside, so if you could ask him questions. And the book is Fordham University Press. It is for sale outside. Thomas, they are the editor. So I want to thank everybody.